I've been born so many times, I thought I knew the score. But you hurt me so bad this time, world, I just can't take it anymore. And it looks like I'm a never gonna be born again. Yeah. Welcome to the video, all the subscribers and the viewers, where you hear the talk that is outside the box. If it doesn't, like, wow, you know, give you like a wow, what is it, what? What did he say? Then it's not doing its purpose. I want to, my purpose is to talk outside the box and keep going outside the box because there is an escape from troubles. But it is truly outside the box of what we've been conditioned to consider, the range of our consideration. And all this conditioning is by design, that we have been designed to only consider within this particular range, okay? And that doesn't work. What we do is we keep opening doors, and behind that door is another door, and behind that door is another door, and then another door, and it keeps getting smaller, 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 and we keep getting cramped, until we're like buried in the ground. So there is a way on the far being entirely right. On the far right of being entirely right is a narrow way that leads home. Anything other than that, you're going to drown. It's all designed that way. You see, we cannot design a way to entirely entrap ourselves, but we can go a long way to make it seem that way. But there's always a way. There's always a way. And I could go on a rant here. I could do all sorts of stuff, actually. But I try to tone everything down so it is not too shocking, actually. But believe me, this is way watered down, actually. But still, we can get to it. We can get to it if the spirit is willing, you know, if we really want to get to it. Yeah, the world has gone too far this time. You know, this time, baby, you hurt me so bad. This time, I can't take it anymore. It's gone overboard. The ship is sinking. And there's a million things you could say, but we don't have time to say it all. All right, so there has to be that which does liberate us from this whimsical madhouse beyond anything we can really say about it, actually. It's such a desperado situation, really. So when we try and come up with outside the box, well, we may struggle for a while. You think like, okay, what is it? What is it we need to see? What do we need to recognize? What do we need to accept? And most of this stuff is so different than what we've been conditioned to believe. We're momentarily like stunned by it, actually. And you think, what? That's the way? I haven't been conditioned to believe that. That's outside my conditioning. And it's tough to get outside our conditioning. It's really, really tough. We have been educated and conditioned to such an extent, along with pre-existing conditioning from other lives, that we are taught that we are special, we're exceptional, meaning we should be able to make an exception to truth. Okay, we're supposed to, like humans are supposed to be able to make an exception to truth. And that's our destiny, you know, that's our mandate from God. But keep in mind that most of the mandates that we think come from God are actually mandates that come from us, and we've assigned them to God. And we say, God, there's a mandate from God, and it's not. But how do we find out it's not? Because most of us, this box consists of following what we think are mandates from God, divine mandates. Now, here is the secret to your liberation and your freedom and your salvation. Here's one way to look at it. We all need to examine these band-aids. How do we do that? We have this inner capacity that God placed there, called the Holy Spirit, which has a functioning which includes what's called reason. And this reason is different than what we call reason, actually. It actually is able to look at these mandates and determine whether they're true or not, whether they come from God, whether we have assigned these to God. There are mandates, and we've assigned them, saying, this comes from God, you know. Yeah, it's able to do that. And our ego screams blasphemy here, because it knows it's curtains for the ego when you do this. Because the reason will say, no, wait, okay, let's just look at this. See, God is not afraid to have reason examine the mandates, because God knows that reason, being a creation of God, is able to determine what is a true divine mandate, what is a true divine law, and what is falsely ascribed to God. Something that the ego has assigned and said, this comes from God. The reason is able to see the difference. But only reason can see the difference. It's the capacity we have within us that the ego says we don't have it. And the ego says, if you do that, you're crazy. You're going to go crazy. You're going to be blasphemous. You're going to attack God, all this stuff. God is not scared for reason to examine all mandates, put all mandates on the table, all of them, everything on the table, and let reason sort through them and take a look at them. That's what I did. And then you're amazed. You say, well, wait a minute. That's not a mandate. Oh, my gosh. You know, that isn't either. And there's another one that's not. And it's like, wow. So you find out that we have a great deal of mandates that we have taught, we have said, we've assigned to God and say, that comes from God. When it doesn't. It doesn't. And so the problem that most of us are in is we think we're following God's law and God's word and doing what God wants us to do. But it's unexamined. And the ego tells us, well, you just have to have faith. Have faith in it. And wait a minute. We're supposed to have faith in God, right? And if God gave us reason, the Holy Spirit, the voice of reason, to examine mandates, then having faith in God is allowing then this reason to function, isn't it? Yeah, it's a pragmatic, functional faith. We're not supposed to have blind faith and mean, well, I'm not going to examine any mandates. No, just the opposite. We're supposed to let reason examine all mandates. And reason will keep, say, yes, follow the ones that are from God, and these others, throw them in the garbage. And this is something that everybody has to do. Otherwise, they will keep following these mandates which are not from God, believing that they're so righteous because they're doing so. Jesus said, I come to bring a new testament, meaning the old mandates, says, no, those aren't coming from God. Here's the real mandates that come from God. Don't put new wine into old wineskins, in other words. You must cast out the old mandates, the mandates that are not true, that we just think, hey, this is what we want. This serves our purpose. We want to become prime creator. And so we cook up all these mandates and say, this is how God wants it. This is what God wants. Not true. Put them to the test of reason. Put them to the test. So when you ask, what is the spiritual path? Put these mandates to the test of reason. Let reason examine them. And in doing so, you will see, ah, wow. This is not right. This is absolutely not right. And it's an amazing thing, and it's a very liberating thing. When you talk about liberation, that's how you get liberated. Okay. You don't get liberated by the ego's ways, even though most people are following those ways, thinking they're mandated from God. They're not. We have made up so many mandates, so many, 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 many. Gradually you see the similarities to them all, and it becomes easy to, you know, cast them aside and say, no, 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 not that, not that, not that, not that. How come there's not more talk like this? I know, like, in communist China back in the day, and probably still, if you criticized the governance of the country, you were labeled insane, because they said, well, the country's perfect, and the governance is from God, and it's perfect. Therefore, you must be seeing something that isn't there. Your complaints are for something that doesn't even exist, and then you must be insane. So, you know, they disappear for mental treatment or, you know, re-education they're never seen from again. It's a similar thing in this world now, is that if you speak up like this, people will say, well, nobody else is speaking up, so you must be crazy, because, right? But I'll tell you a secret about the situation here in the world, is most people are being blackmailed. Most people in this world are being severely blackmailed. I am too, as a matter of fact. But I'm saying it anyway, but it causes me a lot of concern and worry. Because I could have the rug pulled out from under me anytime. The ego is a blackmailer. Okay, this is a fact. And I know for sure that most people watching this video and around the world are being blackmailed. Otherwise, they would speak up. They would be find their voice. They can't find their voice because they're being blackmailed. The ego is a blackmailer, period. And I know in my own life, the ego has tried so hard to blackmail me. That's its stock and trade. That's its business. Its business is to silence us from complaining about what's going on, from saying, hey, I want to examine these mandates. Okay, it wants to silence this. It wants to silence any talk about the Holy Spirit and what the Holy Spirit has advice for us, and then actually implementing that advice. It wants to silence this because its survival depends upon it. And so what it does is it engages in blackmail on many levels, many, many levels. We say USA, you know, free speech. One of the reasons I may have been born here is thinking I can say what I want to say, probably against the advice of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit would have told me, hey, you're going to be blackmailed when you go there, which is true. And it turns out that you definitely, you get put under most extreme pressure if you speak up. Okay, it may not be quite as bad as China, but it's very bad in many ways, actually, and it's getting worse all the time. It's going towards the Chinese model, as a matter of fact, that if you criticize dear leader, you know, you must be insane. If you criticize the ego's agenda, you must be insane. And then all the tools of blackmail come into play. And people have complained about this throughout the ages, saying, wow, I feel I've been blackmailed, I can't say anything. So people don't speak up because they're afraid of all the skeletons and all these repercussions and attacks on them, and having their reputation ruined and all this stuff. You know, blackmail is a vicious business, actually. And that's why they don't speak up. Plain and simple. Plain and simple. Some people on their deathbeds finally speak up, but you know, it's too late at that point, isn't it? That happens a lot. I know, for instance, people on their deathbeds have given confessions, like they say, hey, you know, I encountered some aliens, I had a spaceship and some aliens, I know, and I've been, my whole life I've been carrying this secret because everyone would say I'm crazy, and I was too afraid to even say it, but now I'm dying, what the heck, I'm going to tell you what happened. There's a lot of people on the deathbed confess, you know, the stuff they've been holding within their entire lives, being blackmailed into silence, and some just afraid of social pressures, but many people literally. Now, the ego has all these agents, loyal agents, whose purpose is to blackmail people who might speak up. The ego knows those who might speak up or are speaking up, and they get assigned certain expert agents in blackmail. Agents in blackmail, that's their stock in trade, and they're very, very, very skillful at blackmailing you. And you say, oh my gosh, I don't dare say that, you know? And so you see people trying to speak up, and you realize they're holding back. I say I'm holding back, but it's not because I'm afraid of blackmail. It's because I don't want to shock people too much, because they'll say, oh my gosh, if I get caught listening to that, you know, I'm gonna, my blackmailer is just going to, you know, crush me. So I don't want to say too much. So this is the problem. You have very few people able to even speak up. And it's causing me such severe stress, because I would lose my job. I'd lose my living situation. I'd probably end up destitute if this stuff even came out, that I was even doing any of this. I'm so under such tight, you know, terrible situation as far as being able to speak up. I can't speak up publicly, out in public at all. There's all sorts of stuff. People would jump out of the bushes, you know, blackmailers would, you know, and they're very and clever and devious and how they set you up for all this stuff. I've been through it all. And I went through it just to see what it was like. You know, I said, wow, what's the problem here? How come nobody's speaking up here? I came here and I was shocked. So what's going on here? The truth is not being spoken here in this world. And then I said, okay, let me find out what's going on. And then I allowed myself to be put in all these situations and found out that you get blackmailed here. So I'm speaking up for the people who feel they can't speak up because of these terrible situations. And, you know, I tell the Holy Spirit, hey, get the blackmail off of us. If you want people to witness to you, get the chains off of us, you know. And I don't know. I don't know if that prayer is answered or not. But that's the problem. Otherwise, a lot of people would actually start speaking up. A lot. And, you know, when a stigma is removed from something, a lot of people start speaking up, don't they? They say, wow, yeah, me too, me too, me too, me too. This quote-unquote game, as Jesus puts it, we're playing, it's not a fun game at all. It's not a nice game at all. In fact, it's calling it a game is a bit of a euphemism, actually. We're really trying to teach ourselves how to die, how to be annihilated, how to destroy ourselves. That's more than a game. That's a exercise in pure whimsicality that results in terrible terror and fear and conflict, etc. And it's not good. It's not good at all. We're not really having fun. We're blackmailed into saying we're having fun, actually. You know, just like in a despotic totalitarian country, everybody, how are you doing? I'm loving life here. It's just wonderful. Dear leader's incredible. It's just wonderful. Yeah, there's no smile. I don't want to see any sad faces. Everybody has a smile. Everyone's literally supposed to smile in those countries. Literally. It's like, I'm happy, very happy. Dear leader is perfect. It is incredible. Dear leader's a god. And makes it, you can't go around saying, you know, wow, this place is horrible, wretched. I can't hate this place. Absolutely not. You would disappear for good under those circumstances. So these are the things that we need to hear and say, hey, we're in a box because we're not hearing enough of outside the box. I said the continuity problem is the only problem there is. That is true. What we're trying to do is combine mutual exclusives, which is impossible. Okay? The ego tells us that we can do it. We're just not trying hard enough. We just haven't tried long enough. Okay? That's what we tell ourselves. You know, basically, the ego is just all the lies we tell ourselves. The mind, of course, tells us, but we told the mind we wanted to entertain this idea of replacing God. So the mind is lying to us, and all these lies we call the ego. And it brings about this terrible suffering in life. And trying to get free of it certainly causes a bumpy road. A life is a very bumpy road, but it does lead you to freedom. Whereas other people, they just go through life and think, oh yeah, this is fun, I'm enjoying life. And, you know, and they have no idea how to get free of it. No idea whatsoever. And they just keep, they find the doubling down on dumbness. Now, what's the good of telling people what's going on in the world? Well, I'll tell you what's the good of it, and it's a great good. If you speak up and tell some people, hey, this is what you're doing, you're blackmailers, okay, you're blackmailing. What happens is, when you reveal the truth of the situation, they may seem to hate it, but what happens is, they go to the ego and say, hey, wait a minute, ego, you told me that I'd never get caught at this. Because that's the deal the ego makes with the blackmailers, okay? It tells them, look, you'll never get caught. You know, no one will ever say anything. I'll make sure that you, it's not a problem for you. Don't worry about it. The ego tells this lie. And so they engage in all sorts of, you know, the ego has them engage in all sorts of very nasty leverage type of behavior to try and shut everybody up. Or when a whistleblower comes along, people are outraged, of course. You know, like, ah, how dare you say these things? But then they say, wait a minute, the ego lied to me. The ego completely lied to me. The ego said there wouldn't be any whistleblowers, and there was. So I don't trust the ego, really. I don't really trust the ego. So next time the ego says, hey, I need you to do something for me, and you'll be exalted in the new kingdom if you just shut this person up. You say, whoa, no, wait a minute. What if I get caught? And the ego says, no, you won't get caught, don't worry. He said, no, I remember last time you told me I wouldn't get caught, and I did get caught. So I'm, you know, you're a liar. I'm not going to trust you. I'm not going to do it. That is the benefit. It's the next time that the ego asks when the benefit comes. It's not right now. Right now, people get very upset. Now, there's a lot of blackmailers in the world, all right, and the male and female, but the female is more clever at it, for sure, and they manage to maintain this lily white, you know, reputation of their own. They can't do it. They wouldn't do anything like that. Are you kidding? But that is not the fact at all. They can be very vicious blackmailers. Many, many, many of them are. And, you know, it may sound like, oh, this is a war on women, you know, to point out the dark side of the feminine aspect of the ego, which is male and female, both of the ego. We're actually neutral, genderless spirit. But the female side has a very dark side to it, actually. And all I've seen in the whole time I've been on this planet and observing is only the good side of females has been shown and marketed, and the bad side is that they don't have a bad side. It doesn't exist. Whereas in the past, looking back through history, actually the negative side of both male and females were fully exposed, and people knew, yeah, you know, we are sinners. Both male and female are very bad sinners. Very vicious blackmailers and deceivers, and you know, the men, you know, can do all sorts of, you know, violent stuff, etc. We're both terrible sinners, and so there's an awareness of this now that's gone. And what you have, the marketing and advertising industry, what is pushed forward, the ego's pushed forward, this idealized image of women, the matriarchy, the goddess culture, where women are like the answer. They're the answer to our problems, because they're perfect. They don't have a bad side. Meanwhile, there's probably billions of men on this planet being blackmailed by women right now. Blackmailed, absolutely blackmailed, so they can't say a doggone thing, except yes, dear. You know, that is a fact. And so you'd say, well, you know, the ego says, oh, there's a war on women. You can't say anything bad about them. Well, there's a war on women. Just the opposite. It's the most loving thing you can say. Because again, being a whistleblower, they say, hey, wait a minute, ego, you lied to me. You said I could get away with this, and I'm not. And I'm never going to trust you again. I'm not going to do it again. That is incredibly helpful, actually. Incredibly helpful. It's not a war on women. It's a liberation of women. And men too, okay. But the reason why I'm highlighting women is because they are the ones that the ego has chosen to have this idealized image about and say they can do no wrong, blank check. You know, they have no bad side, which is just the ego saying that it has no bad side. And now there's no blackmail going on, which means the fact that nobody's saying anything means there's nothing to say, right? That is the logic that the ego is pushing on this world. There's nothing bad to say. Nothing bad is happening because no one's saying anything about it. It's all great. It's all good. That the ego says what it's doing. Mutual exclusives. Onward to combining mutual exclusives. No problem at all. No problem. The great leap forward. You know, we're in a global great leap forward. The communist Chinese had their great leap forward with Mao Zedong, and of course they, you know, modernized and thought they could do it. That and what, untold millions starved to death and died except from that, and now they're revising all that and saying no, it was all good. So we're in this great leap forward now globally, where they're saying, hey, it's all good, what are you people talking about, you're nuts, you must be crazy, it's all good. And of course, in China, they say anybody who says, oh, you know, 30 million people died, whatever, they're nuts, they're crazy, you know, they're you know. Great. No, it couldn't have happened. No way. We're great. We're brilliant. You know, we know exactly what we're doing. So the global leap forward now is causing chaos in the world. It is causing so much spiritual angst and suffering and misery on the planet, actually. Horrible, untold stuff. It's devastating. And they say, well, they say nothing's wrong, or, oh, sorry, you know, we're sorry, sorry. But mostly it's the women, you know, they're, now they, the ego's using the women, you know, and they're Teflon, that you can't pin them and say what's really going on. They can say, sorry, we're screwed up, sorry, you know, we screwed up, sorry, and that's it. Supposed to say, oh, okay, that, no problem. It, because we've been trained that they don't have a dark side to them. Whereas in fact, they have an extraordinarily deep dark side, actually. We are bewitched. This planet is bewitched. It's under a spell, okay, of feeling we can't speak up. We can't speak up what's really, we're seeing, what we really know. Say, well, wait a minute. This whole world is a trap. We're being trapped, actually. And the global sacrifice is coming. And, you know, all this New World Order stuff is horrible. We want freedom. We want escape. We want to go home. This game of impermanence just is terrible. We hate it. And we want to listen to the Holy Spirit right now, and we want to get in deep, deep, deep clarity right now, this minute. We want the miracles of the Holy Spirit right now. We're entitled to the miracles of the Holy Spirit right now. Okay? Not when you, bureaucratic face, female bureaucratic face telling us sorry, not when you tell us. We want it right now. Okay, we're not waiting for you to tell us anything, but that's taboo now. You see, that's taboo. So we have all these taboos that I've watched how the world has spun all these into the cultural matrix, as it were. And the matrix is worse than ever right now. And and you see now every one of these faces in this global thing keeps popping up is a woman. As a woman, the U.S. ambassador to the United Nations is a woman. Secretary of State was Clinton was a woman. Sebelius is a woman. You know, the power behind the throne of the United for the president is a woman. And it goes on and on and on. Homeland Security, January, was a woman. And it's like, and you can't, you feel like, oh, I better not really say anything. Because I must be crazy to think that they could do anything wrong. It's not possible. They couldn't do anything wrong. They can't. Maybe a little. They stop and they say, I'm sorry. But other than that, no. Right? This is what's happening. And I predicted it. I absolutely knew it was going to happen. That the ego is going to, and more on the news, it's all women coming in. And in sports, every single sporting contest ends with a woman interviewing the stars hero of the game, or and controlling the questions, controlling the narrative. After all this emotion, this peak emotion is there of just the end of the game. Like, everyone's like, wow, there's the woman interviewing the guy, you know, controlling the narrative, and et cetera, et cetera. It's all by design, all by design. So if you lose sight of the downside of the feminine, the negative side, the dark side, you're lost. You're lost. Same thing with the man. You know, the men, their dark side is largely that they easily are bewitched by women. Easily, way too easily. You know, a man that cannot stand up to a woman is not a man at all. You know, that is a fact. And most, in this world, there's very few men left. Very few men left at all. They can't stand up to women at all. They cannot. They're like paralyzed. It's like some spider bit them or something, and they're in a cocoon. And they simply turn into, you know, shaking, trembling, you know. They're terrified. And having spoken up the way I have, I can tell you that the shock of doing that caused me severe fear reactions, where I'm shaking and trembling out of, and I realize, wow, that's just how strong the conditioning is on people. It is super strong. That if we do speak up, we'll be, you know, targeted and said, you know, that you're you know, war against women, you're suppressionist, you're you know, a sexist, all this terrible, you know, stuff will come at you like that, and more and more deeper and deeper, you know, like that. And But my response is, again, it's the highest, one of the highest forms of love and action in this world to speak up, because again, this will cause them to distrust the ego next time. Next time when the ego says, hey, I got a little favor I want you to do for me, and I will exalt you if you do this. You say, it didn't work out well for me last time, ego. Sorry, I'm not going to do it again. Then the ego will explode with fury at you, of course. And then you'll be shocked, oh my God, the ego's a maniac. And then you'll start saying, help, help, help. And that's when the Holy Spirit comes into the picture. So this is just setting people up for the next, you know, next go around. Helping open the door for the Holy Spirit. Because that's how it works. When you say no to the ego absolutely goes insanely ballistic on you. Believe me, I've been through that. And you have never experienced anything like that in your life. And you're stunned. You're speechless. The ego gets so furious. It's fury like you've never thought is possible. The ego is a house of cards. And when you say no, the entire house of cards starts to collapse and the ego just goes off on you. And then you're so stunned and shocked, you say, oh my gosh, this ego is a complete raving, mad lunatic. And it wants to kill me. And help! I said, anything can help. Please help right now. And then what you find is you start noticing stuff that you didn't notice before. And you say, whoa, how come I didn't notice that before? How come I didn't notice? And there start thousands of little things you start to notice. And you say, wow, I was blind to that before. You're starting to notice outside the box of your conditioning. That's the Holy Spirit at work within you. Okay, reason is starting to sort it out for you. One of these mandates, you know, one of these mandates is that women can do no wrong. Okay. Women can do no wrong except the fact that they're expert blackmailers, which is never brought to light, is it? It used to be, but now we're so progressive now that we've shed these antiquated patriarchal attitudes of criticizing the dear little things, and we're beyond that. We're enlightened. We're in an age of enlightenment. We think women are perfect. You know, they can't do any wrong. And meanwhile, the whole world's being blackmailed. Into silence about the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit can actually do. I don't mean the puerile, watered-down, religious stuff, okay? That's just, you know, habit. It's not organic, it's not living. You know, Pope Benedict said that Vatican II brought it into the church, really, and it became just a thing instead of an organic, living process, and he was absolutely right. Very brilliant. Pope, actually, the previous Pope, and he quit. Why did he quit? Because he knew it's over. It's over. And we're in a Vatican II type of world right now, where we're supposed to get on with it and forget about the stuff that came in the before. Which was actually, we had much better common sense, we had much better reasoning capacity, we were much more honest, we were much more truthful, and people much more willing to actually see what's actually going on. We're now in a state of collective hypnosis, delusion, actually, right now. And we're being led down the primrose path. And we're being told the media's frantically trying to do damage control and tell us everything's fine. What are you guys worried about? Everything's fine. No problems at all. What are you so concerned about? Oh, you're worried? Oh, you must be a lunatic, you know, lunatic fringe or something. Yeah. And you know, corporate world has declared war on those who are saying, hey, you know, I'm not feeling it. You know, I'm just not feeling it. Corporate world says, well, you know, you better feel it, and we're going to make sure you feel it. That's what's going on right now. So, it's we can think outside the box, but at the same time, the pressure is on to not think outside the box. So it has to be fast, actually, and I've always said that. I've keep telling the Holy Spirit, come on, faster, you got to go faster. Because if you try to go slow, and react to everything that's going on. It's too much. It's too much. You can't do it. You can't do it. So this liberation has to come in a timely manner. It has to come fast. And I've said that my whole life. Hey, you know, you can't wait. You can't wait around in these times. There's no way. You're not going to make it then. You're not going to make it. There's too much suction down the drain at this point in time. So I keep on pushing things severely in my own life, to the point of just near collapse. Because I say that if we don't get it soon, you know, we're not going to get it. And that has consequences. And we're going to drown. We're going to go down with a ship. I had a dream last night. It was a terrible, terrible dream. This lady, first I surveyed this land up above in a plane. I said, oh my God, it's this gigantic bog, swampish bog with all these houses in it. But it was just terrible place. And I found myself down on the ground in this house, and this lady said, hey, I had this vial of liquid. And she said, hey, I'm going to bring life to everything here. Follow me, follow me. So we got in got in a boat, went out into the middle of this lake, and we had these oars were like trench shovels digging trenches or something. I said, what the heck are these oars? This is something that's crazy, cuckoo here. And then suddenly the boat started sinking. And then she was underwater, and I realized that this is what she wanted. She wanted me to sink and drown. And I just frantically started swimming, and I looked around, and all these houses and stuff and concrete embankments, there was nowhere to get out of the lake. And finally I saw one spot. I was able to pull myself up, and that's when I saw this door, and I opened it. There's another door, and opened that, another door, and I found myself. I said, whoa, this is a trap. Went to the far right of the lake, extreme right there, and there was like a branch, a willow tree, some kind of branch hiding, and I saw some light, and I pulled it aside, and I looked, and there was a stairway that led up. And then I saw this lush, green, beautiful golf course and beautiful place. I said, I'm home. I know the way home now. I'm oriented once again. And I said, wow, that was a narrow escape. Terrible, terrible thing. And it was, I'm telling you, that there's an extreme attempt to get us to all go down with the ship, to drown. Now, this world, what is this world? It's an attempt to base life upon a foundation of death. If you really look at it, what our society right now, what is it run on? What is everything made of, run on? Except it is made of fossil fuels. Just about everything, you know. It's all made of fossil fuels. What is fossil fuel? It's death. It's the death of all these small organisms over billions of years, having these deposits. And now we are then sucking this death up. Okay. And living off of this death. This planet is really, if you look at it honestly, it's we're trying to live off of death. Houses we have, you know, trees, they died, the trees were all cut down and died, and now we're living in houses. Everything we have, food, animals, we kill animals and then we eat them, you know, we're living off of death. To a huge extent, we're trying to learn how, we're trying to say that life comes from death here. That's what this planet's all about. It's like a peat bog, and they want to keep adding, more death. This lady was sinking the ship. She wanted me to die, my body to sink to the bottom of this peat bog and, you know, create more organic matter that eventually gets turned into fuel that some future inhabitants of the planet will use to heat their homes. But we're all running on death here. It's not a good place at all. It's not a good place at all. So I saw there is a way to get to another place. Absolutely there is. Stairway. When I ran up the stairway, I saw the whole thing, how it's set up. And they, of course, they tried to camouflage it with having a tree limb. Like, there's nothing there. There's nothing there. But I saw this light over there. I saw some faint light. I said, wait a minute. I think there's something over there. I went over there, and sure enough, there was an escape from this terrible peat bog that we call planet Earth. And a lot of the people who are saying how wonderful it is are actually being blackmailed, okay? Yeah, so don't judge two people too harshly, I'm telling you that. Try to refrain from judging people individually. It's very important. because you don't really know what's going on with them. You can be blackmailed so bad that you have to end up being a spokesperson for the position of the blackmailer. And like Patty Hearst was a spokesman for the Symbionese Liberation Army, you end up saying, hey, you know, you end up being the head cheerleader, where in fact, it's all because you're being blackmailed. Yeah. Often the case, so things are not as they appear to be on the surface. For instance, the President of the United States, what is he about, okay? He's really a salesman. He's just a salesman. He's not setting the agenda at all. He's being dictated to. There's a corporate New World Order structure is telling him, this is the product we want you to sell. And then he's out there selling it. Okay, but why is he doing that? I don't know, you know, but it's possible. He's been severely blackmailed. That's possible. You know, he's just like, he probably can't wait to the day for the day until he's out of this situation. I'm telling you that. There's so much deviousness going on the planet, so much viciousness. It's just, you know, it's almost immeasurable. So things are not as they seem to be on the surface. That is for sure. So don't waste time, you know, blasting other people, specific people too much. Try to kind of look at the bigger picture of just saying it's the ego. And what is the ego? It's our own desire. And our own desire for what? Our own desire to learn how to die. Why do we have it? Because we want to be prime creator. And why does that need us to die? Because the prime creator created us as we are. We can't change that. We can't become something different. So we can't become prime creators. Impossible. So the only avenue we have is to believe it's possible that we can destroy what we are. We can annihilate what we are. So on all reality, we can simply define what is true. We just say, okay, this is what we want to be true, and it's therefore it's true. Just make up our own reality, our own facts. But we can't do that as long as we remain what we are, which is one with truth, reality, facts, divine truth, one with the prime creator, one with all creation. We are still that. And so all we can do is think that there must be a way that we can get rid of what we are, so then we can claim that we're something different, namely the creator of our own truth, prime creators. So that's where it comes from. It doesn't really come from all these actors and salespeople and women, you know, saleswomen on the stage, salesmen, saleswomen. They have very bad habits, you know, and it's not like we're cutting them slack either. It's not like, you do need to hold them accountable, because next time they'll say, whoa, I'm not going to do that again, you know. Speaking truth to authority is very important, because at least next time they'll say, hey, there's no way I'm going to do that role anymore because I got caught red-handed. And you said I wouldn't get caught, and I did. So I don't trust you, ego. See? So there is some love behind speaking truth to authority. And on the other hand, you don't want to go down with a ship also, because it's also very important to show people you can escape from this terrible matrix. And then they say, hey, ego, you said no one could escape, and somebody escaped. You lied to me. Maybe I could have escaped if I tried. And the ego says, because the ego tells everybody, don't even try. There is no escape. And let me instead, indulge in sensory pleasures, etc. And you say, well, wait a minute, you know, what if somebody does escape? Then I feel totally like I wasted my life. The ego says, don't worry. No, nobody will escape, because there is no escape. So don't worry about that. So everybody says, okay, ego. And then somebody escapes, and people say, what? You know, what the H, you know? You said no one would escape. Somebody escaped. You lied to me. I wasted my life, you know. Now, here's another thing. You know, it's called tough love. Tough love is effective love, actually. And the ego's totally scared of it. You know, a real religion is tough love. It really is. And people used to have a lot more of that, you know, pre-Vatican II, etc. There's a lot of tough love in the world. You tell people, tell them what's really going on, okay? And they may hate it at first, but later on, that's when the payoff is for them in all sorts of varieties of tough love, telling them the truth of their situation. And, you know, there are many examples I could use. One just slipped my mind now for a second. It may come back or it may not. It doesn't matter. The principle is the same. in the same way you can speak to religious people who are just stuck in their habits, but they don't, it's not a living organic thing for them. You say, hey, you know, you're missing the boat. And again, the ego says nobody will escape, someone escapes. People say you lied. Now here it is, one of the most important things we can do is to realize we wasted our lives. Now that may seem like a very cruel statement there, okay, but I can tell you, if you can get to that point, it's one of the best places you could ever be. It's to say, hallelujah, my God. Why? Because if you didn't get there, you would have gone on continuing to waste your life until the day you died. Most people, even at the moment of death, they're still wasting their life. They would take it all the way through death, almost everybody. But if you can say right now, you know what? I've wasted my whole life. I've never spoken up. I've never really said what I wanted to say. I've been intimidated. I've been blackmailed. I've been pressured. And I've been too afraid of the continuity issue, and I've just simply wasted my life. I've really not done what I wanted to do at all. Then you can say, wow, ego, you told me I would have a good life, and now I'm realize I wasted my life. You lied to me. You lied. I don't trust you, ego. You're a liar. And then so the next time the ego tells you, hey, This is good for you. You know, this will be a good life. You say, no, ego, you lied to me. I don't trust you anymore. I can see you're just trying to waste my life again. So the benefit of realizing you've wasted your life and acknowledging it, it's called repentance. Repentance says, hey, God, I've wasted my life. The ego has just totally wasted my life, and now I'm sinking, I'm ready, and almost dying, and I totally missed the boat, you know. Repentance. And then God says, great. Holy Spirit says, great. Now let's make sure you don't do it again and start making amends right away. You know, that is tough love, and that's effective. So that is why I use negative statements, because it's true. That's the way to go. See, you know, I've wasted my life, because I guarantee you almost everybody on this planet have entirely wasted their lives. Haven't done what they wanted to do at all. Just delay. Just 100% delay, and that's it. It's those who recognize that and say, my gosh, I'm wasting my life. Those are the ones who start repenting and saying, wow, I don't trust the ego. What's going on here? Let's get full disclosure on the ego. Okay. Don't worry about the president or whatever. It's a full disclosure on it. Get full disclosure on the ego. Because that's the one that's pulling all the strings behind the scenes. That's the puppet master. The real puppet master is the ego. It's even behind the goddess, the matriarchy complex. It's even behind that, which is why I mentioned the goddess, matriarchy, all this stuff, just to, you know, tough love, to out it, to whistleblow it. But really behind that is the ego. And behind the ego is our own desire to be prime creator. And the more you out that, the more you whistleblow it, the clearer you get on it. You say, hey, I don't want to keep doing that. And you start getting motivated. If you realize you've wasted your life, that's a very strong motivational thing, isn't it? And I'm still wasting my life, you know? I've been blackmailed into just a very narrow avenue of expression here, really. It's terrible. I'd like to be out in public more and bringing it stronger. But right, as of this moment, you know, I'm unable to do it. So for me, I certainly still have regrets, absolutely. How can you not? And we all should have regrets, and we all should recognize those regrets. And that's what repentance is all about. And yet the ego is telling us we have nothing to repent about. Like, what regrets? What are you talking about? Yeah. How many times you go to Disneyland? Wow. What you got to complain about? You know? I mean, wow. This world, I mean, don't you have a nice car? You know, and you go down to the burger place. What's their complaint about? All the music, all this music, and got all these, you know, you get any kind of music you want. You got all these movies. You must be crazy to be complaining. You must be suffering from some sort of insanity to complain. What are you talking about? Wasting your life. You led a rich life. My gosh, didn't you get some kind of degree? College degree? You got some money, good money. Man, you've traveled somewhere, you've had an incredible life. That's what the ego tells you. Total lies. If you compare like my life to, you know, a person who supposedly has a rich life, it is no comparison at all. You can't even compare it at all. My life has been so intense, so much more fulfilling than any of these people who think they've had rich lives. It's like a penny to, you know, $1 trillion. But even then, I still feel I've wasted my life, you see. So we have to really push aside and repent. The more you repent, then the more your life gets on track. And you realize you're trying to base your life on a foundation of death, is what you realize. And you say, I can't do it. That's ridiculous. Whatever dies was never alive in the first place, right? So here we are in this peat bog we call planet Earth, and we're all expected to, you know, deposit our organic remains into this bog, and like it's always done, you know, dying off. There's all these dying off times, you know, ELE, extinction level events that always occur on this planet to just create, you know, massive more deposits of organic matter that undergoes certain changes and pressures and heat and everything, that turns into fuel for future, you know, future inhabitants, etc. All sorts of stuff take place on this planet, and we don't realize that we are living, we are in this crazy, lunatic, whimsical game, so to speak. Now, Jesus often speaks in big, wide terms, okay? Okay, that's fine. Sometimes it seems cavalier, but it's true. What he says is true. It's right on, but sometimes we can feel like, wow, you know, what do you mean just follow your joy, everything's fine? Just see the world as all love and everything's fine. You know, it seems very cavalier because we're being blackmailed. You know, we're suffering, we're drowning. You know, that's what's really happening, actually. So it's good to have some little more context, put a little salt on it, and fill it out here. With this extra, you know, a little bit of extra. I get irritated a little bit by it sometimes, but then I say, well, you know, it ultimately what he's saying is true. You know, from his perspective, the big picture, you know, it's ultimately true. But we're having a hard time getting there, so we have to you know, keep repenting. And one of the ways is, of course, to say, ego, you tricked me, you lied to me, and I've suffered so bad, I'm not going to listen to you again. That's very helpful, very valuable. Now, are there some tools that can really, you know, free us like that? There are. And I've introduced some of these tools along the way. But the escape is camouflaged, and in our panic, like I'm in this dream last night, I was looking around, where can I go? There's nowhere for me. You know, it's like a lake, and there's like concrete embankments coming straight out of the lake, and I can't climb up them. You couldn't get out of the lake. It's like a bathtub, you're in this gigantic bathtub, and it's porcelain. You can't get out. Then I was able to finally find a very difficult way, and then eventually see the actual easy way out. But if we're panicked and we're blackmailed and we're pressured, definitely we're stuck very badly. So the first thing is to get a feeling of not panicking. Okay, it's very important. Now, what I have found on the internet and the media and everything that's going on as far as information society is that they're driving you to panic. Okay, they're driving you to panic. They're talking topically in a certain way, but they're pushing you into panic. And all the comments to the people, it's so panicky. I'm telling you, I look at thousands and thousands of comments, and I don't find a single one that has wisdom in it. I really don't. The people are more and more and more and more, they're acting like, you know, trapped animals, trapped in a cage. And this whole mood of panic is terrible. It's terrible when it grips you, because you lose sight of your options. You lose sight. Say, wait a minute. Keep your head about you. You know, wait a minute. How about maybe over there? Okay, this didn't work. Okay, drop that over there. Okay, you know, able to think clearly, be able to keep your head about you under these times. I think Rudyard Kipling, that you'll be a man that's on, or something, some poem saying that when you can, when everyone's losing their heads around you, and you can keep yours, then you're a man, my son, or a woman, my son. Same thing. So this, the time we're living, is a time of panic, actually. Now, when I talk about Comet Isonix there like that, that doesn't mean I'm trying to panic anybody. I'm trying to say, look, this stuff is part of the matrix stew. And you need to be aware of what's going on, what's the potentials, etc. So you say, yeah, I'm familiar with that, you know. And you don't, when things might get bad, you don't get caught up into it. It's called backburning, okay? If you're a firefighter, you know exactly what I'm talking about. And wildfires, when there's a huge wildfire coming on a town, they will burn around the town, control the burn, so then the fire, wildfire comes, the fuel's already been burned there, and it can't jump, you know, over to the town, saves it. So you need to do backburning and look at this stuff. And so when it comes, you say, yeah, I know all about that, and okay, I'm not panicking. I'm still thinking, okay, where's still the escape from this draconian scenario that's taking place in the world? You don't lose your mind at that point. So, I mean, some people might say, oh, you're sowing fear, etc. Well, it's tough love I'm sowing, actually. And you got to do your homework. You know, I still have to do some homework on Ison, as a matter of fact. Comets in general. There's way too much foreshadowing going on. They're so intense. Who knows if I'll do a video on it or not, but there is intense foreshadowing taking place with comets in general. I don't know if Ison is the one in particular, but I really feel that there's going to be a comet eventually that is really going to be intensely problematical. Now, it could be Ison. It could be. It might not. If Ison passes, no problem. At least we're getting up to speed on comets, okay, in general, right? And you're seeing the bigger picture of, whoa, you know, what is this world we're in, you know? What is this world we're in? The extinction-level events have happened throughout history. This is a fact. And thanks to the scientists that have been the whistleblowers on this, who have proven it, absolutely. And they're still arguing over, you know, the Noah's flood and that, and the sinking of Atlantis and all these kind of things. But there have been many extinction-level events, and it's covered up. It's very much covered up. I mean, where do the Egyptians come from? Where do the Sumerians come from? Come on. You know, well, some say they were seeded by extraterrestrials, which is true. Sumerians, for sure. But, you know, people have survived ancient cataclysms, etc., and brought with them the knowledge of that, and then they became the, you know, like the aristocrats of the new civilization, etc. This planet is far different than what the official corporate narrative is, you know. Go to Mackie D's, you know, and be happy. Go to the Golden Arches and smile. You know, how come you're not smiling? You're supposed to be happy here. This is a wonderful place. Now, the whole thing about Jesus saying, well, you can live an unbelievably lovely life here, is true in the absolute sense of accepting the Holy Spirit's, you know, vision, overlay. But you can't make any exceptions to that. So, I mean, it can be frustrating for people to hear this stuff, this Pollyannish stuff. It's true, as long as you don't make a single exception. But how do you not make a single exception? So, see, it's that's the devil's in the details, and you can't make a single exception. In other words, there's no specialness. The overlay, Christ means the oil. There's no specialness. What we really need is a self without a center. We need the vision of a selfless center, a self without a center. Okay, that's the Christ child. The Christ child is a self without a center. But we need to have that self, that center, sit beside us, not lead us, sit beside us. And we just simply abide in the presence of that centerless self and recognize it's temporary. Okay? You might wonder, how in the world can I possibly do it? The way to escape is you allow the centerless self to sit down next to you, as it were, in your awareness, okay? And you must realize and accept this is temporary. This is temporary. And you think, well, when it leaves, what happens? Well, all of existence is temporary. All perception is temporary. It's not going to leave until you're just ready to set down all perception, but it still is temporary. So you're not trying to form something permanent with it. You're abiding in it. Ramana Maharshi said, abide in the self, meaning the self, centerless self. That is the solution. He is absolutely correct. I often think that if you took Ramana Maharshi, Ananda Maimon, Jesus Christ, and Buddha, and put them all together, and took the best of everything, you know, you'd have the perfect teaching, actually. So I do pick from, you know, various teachers, you know, because they all rise within a culture and a tradition and stuff that makes it seem uneven in some ways. But abiding in this, abidance, you're not trying to form a permanent relationship with the Christ child. You're letting it sit next to you and simply experiencing, wow, there's no center to this self. In other words, there's no specialness. There's no concentration of something in a special place. It's all evenly distributed, like oil upon water. So oil evenly distributes, doesn't it? That's why the metaphor of Christ means anointed with oil. The metaphor of oil is evenly distributed. There's no center. There's no center where you say, oh, there's where the self is, because there's its concentration. It's concentrated there, and it's less over there. No, even distribution everywhere without a center. Just abide in that. Recognize, and how do you abide in it? By recognizing this temporary. Which may seem like a paradox. Why would I want that to be temporary? Very important attitude. It's the key to the whole thing, is recognizing this too is temporary. But since you recognize, you say, why should I tell it to go away then? I already know it's temporary. It's going to go away eventually, so let it go away. When it goes away, it goes away. I already know it's temporary, along with everything else. You see, it removes this incredible egoic block that we have when we accept even the remedy to the continuity issue with crisis we have. That too is temporary. But it goes at the same time as everything else goes. Okay, it all will go at once. So in the meantime, you abide there with it. It takes the wind out of the ego's sails when you acknowledge, this too is temporary. You know, people, like when they want to go see a guru or something, they want to make intense eye contact and say, you know, it's like, okay, there's, you're the center of the self is right here. I'm seeing the center of the self, you know. But really, the way to do it is you simply sit beside them on the side or somewhere, and you don't even have to look at them, actually. You might just notice them, but then you look away and you say, this too is temporary. And you're feeling this quality of centerlessness there, okay? You feel it, you're aware of it. But you're saying, oh, this too is temporary, but I'm enjoying it. It's reminding me of something, which is its only purpose, is to remind us. So, again, you don't have this personal faux fixation on the guru, the sage, etc. Not supposed to have any personal fixation on them. They're not the center of anything. They're just showing you that they, too, are abiding next to the centerless self, the self without a center. And just abide there and experience it like that. And it's not an end in itself. It's temporary, not an end in itself. So, okay, self without a center, let's see what you remind me of. That's the attitude. Okay, you're here, let's see what you remind me of. And just sit quietly and see See what you're reminded of. That's it. So if you see Jesus walking down the street, say, Jesus, hey, hi. Okay. Let's sit. Sit beside me. Sit down beside me here. Let me experience what your presence reminds me of. That's all. Don't have to really say anything or not say anything, but just see what comes up as far as being reminded of what. What are we reminded of? Yeah, that's it. That's very doable, isn't it? Whereas the idea, like, oh, there's Jesus, I have to have a personal, intense personal relationship with him. Oh, my God, oh, my God, oh, God. It's like, wow. Yeah. No. That's completely wrong. That's the ego. Why do you need a relationship with what's temporary? You don't. It's the only usefulness of what is temporary is to remind us what is not temporary, what is eternal. So it's a remembrance that we need. That's why Nana, my mom, Mama Maharshi were so impersonal. They're so impersonal. They seem to have no interest in personal relationships whatsoever. None. Even those who were very close to them their entire lives, they said, I don't feel like I have any personal relationship or whatsoever. And it's like she's still completely distant from me. And it's like really, it really bothered them because they thought, if I just serve her for a long time, she'll finally, you know, acknowledge, you know, that I'm special or something. And it never happened. And some of those close to her really looked, you know, kind of like very disillusioned. You know, it was really tough love for them. Very tough love for them. Quick road, though, for them if they can eventually, you know, accept it. They had a hard time accepting it. Super distant. People felt just utterly distant from them. Like more than a universe away, you know, just so remote. Complete sense of remoteness there. But it wasn't that, it's just that the complete recognition of the temporariness of all this. And just abiding in the centerless self, there's no center. So they're looking for a center. They say, well, her center must be very remote because I can't find it. Now, there was no center. There was no center. So, see, they misinterpreted it. They think, thinking, I just can't find her center. It feels so far away. It's so far away, and I just can't get to it. It's too far away from me. If they just said, no, wait a minute. She doesn't have any center. There is no center. And just abide there and see what it reminds you of. Then it would have lifted their whole depression and glumness and everything, you know. It's like, wow, what's wrong with me? I can't find her center. I can't really relate to her. I'm missing it. You know, no, they're not missing anything. There is no center there. In her case, actually, she had no center at all to her being here. None. So, it's not that tough at all if you see it the way it is. I'd relish the opportunity, you know. Why not? What does it remind me of, is all I would think. I don't care. There's no center there. There's no there. It, you know, it's seamless, non-concentrated, overlay, bliss. So what does that remind us of, is the only question. There's no ma there. Okay, ma is not home. There's no ma. Ananda my ma was not there. There was no Ananda my ma. There was just this seamless bliss. But what does that remind us of, is the question. Not seeking for her. There was no her there. And people kept searching for it, and eventually she just, you know, there's like almost nothing there. The bliss just kind of dried up in a lot of ways because people kept thinking, okay, I think we found it. I think we found her, you know. And in finding her, they lost her, as it were, because there was no her there. The usefulness of it dried up. Not on her account. She said, no, it's just people, this is how they want to see me. So this is how I am, because there is no me here. So when they insist that there's a me here, my potency is a potency of remembrance is dwindles and is lost, and that's what happened. It started happening, I think, in the 70s with her, actually. Potency began to be lost. I noticeably is, you know, drying up because people thought they, you know, okay, we're now more hip to what's going on. And unfortunately, happens. That happens here. Because people are stupid. They're the whimsicality, the bad habits, the fear, the continuity issue, the blackmailing of everybody here in one way or the other, it causes them to just, you know, miss it. Jesus said to everybody, you know, hey, you're missing it. Even said to his apostles, you're missing it. You really don't know who I am really at all. You don't know what's going on. You're missing it. But listen to the Holy Spirit, and it'll explain it to you throughout the millennia. It'll explain. But they told him point blank, you're not getting it. Because there's nothing to get. That what you think you're trying to get isn't here. At all. There's nobody here. There's no person here. There's no quote-unquote self that you're looking for here. The self you see is a self without any center at all. And by your definition, that's no self at all. But it's the resolution to the continuity problem. That's for sure, which is all we need. Now, the bad news is we cannot resolve the problems of the world. It's impossible. No way at all. The good news is we don't need to. We don't need to resolve the problems of the world at all. All we need to do is be reminded of reality. That's it. That is all we need. And abiding with the center, a self without a center, is how we do it. Call it the overlay, and call it a lot of different things. But the Christ child, the Krishna child, Krishna consciousness, whatever you want to call it, it's abiding with this and recognizing it's temporary. You don't need to build temples to it, or churches, or whatever, you know. You don't need to build all this stuff. Saying, here's the center. You see, the desire for a center says, oh, we got a center. We got this center now. And this big, huge center misses the point entirely. Because what comes to remind us of reality has no center. The centerless center really is the centerless center. And all you need to do is just sit, abide with it, abide with it. And be reminded of reality beyond perception, because reality is not perceived, it's known. It's known. And the knowing is not the kind of knowing we're thinking of. It's knowing without any exception, any possibility of not knowing. It's knowing without any possibility of not knowing. It's not dualistic knowing. And we cannot conceptualize it at all. Not at all. It can only be known. Knowing can only be known. Okay? So how do we get from perception to knowing? Abiding with the centerless self. The Christ child within us is within us. The centerless self is within us. The Holy Spirit is the centerless self, as it were, for us. The grace of God abides within us as the centerless self. Okay, abide with it. How do we do that? Recognizing it's temporary. Don't get carried away. Because you're not trying to have a relationship with it. You're trying to it's a pragmatic tool. It's an expedient to remind us of reality. It's a fabulous expedient, but it's still an expedient. Still an expedient. Even the Christ child is an expedient. It's a tool. It's a way to remind us of reality, so the continuity crisis problem is solved for us. So don't get carried away with it. And I tried to teach this when I was young, and people said it was blasphemous. Like, what are you talking about? I mean, if you're in the presence of Christ, you're going to be completely carried away by it. I said, no. That's all wrong. And you know, look at the world now. Look at the world now. People are so out of whack. It is, you know, it's tragic, really. I don't like to think about it. It's really tragic. Now, from the standpoint of the centerless self, it's not tragic, but that's the standpoint of the centerless self. And that's what we need to abide with, you know, during these times. Otherwise, we're probably going to go nuts just from, I mean, I hate to see people suffering. I hate to see any suffering at all, any death at all, anything like that. I absolutely, it just, you know, devastates me. So, you know, just from the standpoint of not being devastated, I need to be reassured, you know, that there is a way to remember reality. Otherwise, you know, I can't function in this world. No way. So only knowing can know knowing. All right, that's it. Perception cannot know knowing. It cannot. So even the perception of the Christ child is not knowing. It's not. Its only function is to bring about a sense of remembrance. And it definitely can do that. Definitely. So again, don't get carried away. That's the problem with the path of devotion is, oh, you're God, you get carried away, and I gotta have a personal relationship with you, and you know, all this stuff. That's missing the... I think it's said that everybody eventually has to become a Yani, eventually. And the Yani seems cold to most people, like, how come you're not a devotee, and oh, you're going crazy, you know, so, well, you're in the presence of Christ, are you? How come you're not just, you know, just gushing and all this stuff. No. Because it's an expedient. And be quiet. Let the mind be quiet. And just see what remembrance comes up for you. The remembrance is greater than even the Christ child. It's even greater. That's the whole point of it. And the remembrance is going to be beyond words. That's the whole point of it. If you could pin it down with words, it's not going to be effective for you, really, because again, it's a halfway house between perception and knowing, actually, where the perceptions become so holistic, as it were, that it's a travesty to try and take a snapshot of words, you know, of it. If you're going to use words, then use them in a very creative way. Like the header banner on the website here, the YouTube channel. It just shows. Don't try too hard for words. If you do, let it be really creative. But then, go beyond that too. Go beyond that. Don't try to put in some linear format. You know, don't appeal to that side of your. Thinking. And the dream is with the far right, I don't know if the left, right brain, left brain, I don't know how that works, but somehow in the very, very, very far as part of the right side, that's where I saw it's possible, that's where you can escape. Now, it could be the right side of the brain in some way or something, right? I mean, whatever, there's something there. You have to go all the way there. Because again, the point is remembrance. So if you are trying to make a movie script about it and put it into words, you're not remembering at that state. You've gone into a non-remembered state. Not to say that you can't talk while you're remembering, yes. But if you're trying to capture the essence of it in words, you are not in the remembered state, really. You're not. Because when you're in the state of remembrance, you're not really focused on words. You're not trying to capture it. The effectiveness is it goes beyond what can be captured. And we have to kind of look at this. And maybe, you know, in videos to come, I will get closer into this, right? And we'll get even closer, more close up of the state of mind that we need to be in. It's definitely a state of mind that can help us escape from this tragedy that is taking place on this planet right now. A tragedy we've been warned about. We were warned about it, and we're supposed to have prepared for it. And those who are doing this good work of preparing, you know, you won't regret it. absolutely not. Even though it may seem indirect, you won't regret it. Okay. Let's wrap this one up. I know there's a World Series Game 6 going on right now, and I said, you know what, I'm not going to wait. I'm going to tape this instead of watching World Series Game 6, because this is more important. Even though I'm incredible, huge, have been my entire life, I know baseball incredibly well, but I'm saying this is more important than potential of Boston Red Sox clinching the World Series. It is more important. Or St. Louis staving off is more important, way more important. So that is servicey. That is choosing, deciding what is really important, and then following through on that and doing it. Not trying to do both. I couldn't do both. I realized I can't both watch the World Series and do this taping, because the time is now when I'm on point. And if I wait till after the World Series, all that emotion, all that stuff, I will be exhausted. I won't be able to do the taping for sure. Okay? So that's where it's at. That's where it's at. Okay, remember, tough love. Don't run from it. Embrace it. Say, this is good. I wasted my entire life. How wonderful that I'm seeing that right now. Oh, yeah, okay. I've been blackmailed, or I'm a blackmailer. How wonderful to see that, because I'm never going to trust the ego again. I love whistleblowers, because they, even when they're blowing the whistle on me, because I realize then I'm going to say, hey, the ego, you lied to me. You're a liar. I'm going to see you, or I'm not going to ever trust you again. And that opens the door to the Holy Spirit. So it's all good. It's all good. Nobody's being targeted. No mean-spiritedness here. I'm saying it's all good, because eventually you'll start distrusting the ego, which is key. You never can be saved as long as you're trusting the ego. No way. No way. You have to say, you know what, ego, I don't trust you. Please, I need help with this crazy ego. And then the Holy Spirit will start gently. You start noticing stuff, that's all. You start noticing. And eventually, you're able to notice what the ego's really up to. And then you're able to focus on the right attitude, right, to abide with the centerless self, which reminds you of reality, which solves the continuity problem, which enables you to go home. It's that simple. All right, stick with it. That's it.